So, hi everyone. I'm really happy to see you all here for the meetup, first of all. And on the other side, I'm also really happy to present to you already some part of my talk that I want to give at the EmberConf this year. And this talk will be about animations in Ember.js and how we can actually do them. So for the next, roughly 20-30 minutes, I will tell you more about like web animations and also give you like kind of like sneak peek on a demo I'm preparing for this talk. So first of all, if we think about animations, there might be several things that come to our mind, right? So you, or most of you, are probably like professional developers, right? So if you think about web animations, you might have something like this in mind, right? Like a really nice button, you see the CSS is perfectly kind of like adapted to it. And you might think about like user interactions and how you can actually enhance these interactions with animations on the web. You might think about like really more cheesy stuff, like a really nice GIFs or something like that, right? So this is something that you see in your everyday work life or not. But also as Ember developers, you might think about something like this. I wasn't familiar with this logo before, but maybe some of you recognize it. It's like the logo for like Ember Liquidfire. And yeah, probably many of you have already like played with page transitions and how to like add animations to like elements on the page depending on user interaction. But the interesting thing is, in my talk, actually, I don't really want to talk about all of these things. I think these kind of like enhanced user interactions are really interesting in the sense of that they sweeten up the kind of like the impression that the user gets from your website. And they're kind of like, I would say, animated sugar for UX. They kind of like, enhance it, but they're actually not like the core part of the user interaction. It's like something else. It's actually the website that you're building, right? So in my talk, actually, I want to talk more about how you can actually create full-blown animated content. And I want to show you how you can also create your own kind of like stories on the web, doing animated storytelling through images. And so in this talk, as you can already see, it's more about actually creating stories, creating content, and leveraging the power of animations. So now that we have this out of the way, I want to just like briefly show you what the outline could be of this. So first of all, I would like to give you like a short introduction into where animations are actually coming from, so you know more about that. Then also I want to present some web tools and some web APIs that you can currently use to actually create animations on the web. And on the last part, I want to actually show you a first demo on how you can actually create animations in Ember with a specific web API that we will talk about later. So, really nice, bright slide. Let's talk a little bit about the history. So first of all, animations, what is this actually? Like a definition, I just quickly looked it up. It says something like, it's the process of making the illusion of motion and the illusion of change by means of the rapid display of a sequence of images that minimally differ from each other. So this actually just means we have like a sequence of images, and once we show them with a specific kind of like frequency, we actually get out of like these still images a real animation. This is something that just like happens by us human beings looking at something in our environment and actually realizing, oh, I cannot distinguish single images anymore. It kind of like will be modulated to something that we perceive as emotion. So this is quite interesting, and this is also where like traditional animation actually comes from. So it's all about just showing you a sequence of images fastly. So for example, already 200 years ago, 1830s or something, you would have devices like these. They're kind of like these carousels with like slits in it, and you can look through it. When you kind of like turn around the carousel, it will seem as if you would see like a kind of movie, although it's actually like just like, I don't know, maybe 8 or 10 different still images attached to each other. So this is actually quite amazing if you think about it, because this is like 200 years ago, and Still nowadays, if you want to create animations, this is like a very similar route that you can actually get into. Actually doing, yeah, sequential animations or frame by frame animations. Also, yeah, a lot of other old cartoons that you might already have seen every now and then, for example, like from the 1920s, have evolved from there, and this is where you actually could really, yeah, talk about animations in the sense as we know them nowadays, as they were like animated together with sound, so they would be created as like full-blown movies. So, this is like about the history for now. And let's talk a little bit about like web tools and web APIs that we can actually use. Oh, no, now I got the joke away. So, it's maybe many of you already have like a lot of experience in the development of websites as developers on the web since quite some time. Probably there's one single thing that you all think about that you have used in the past every now and then, or maybe really, really often, that created actually animations for you. Yeah, that's right, it's Flash, really nice. And it was actually like a really, yeah, kind of like popular tool for people, not only for developers, but also for designers to create the animated content. And it was quite amazing until like, yeah, one point you had actually some issues with it. It was actually not this awesome platform of the web anymore. Like, you would sometimes go to YouTube and see like, messages like this, you have to upgrade your Adobe Flash player to actually watch this, and at some time point you realize, okay, the support, the browser support is not really there anymore, like people were not really directly working, yeah, to actually do this. And you would also see like over the years, like actually developers themselves, they decided at some time point to opt out of using Flash and using something else. So Flash was actually, yeah, super approachable, and I think like there was a really large toolkit around it to actually make animations work, but there was also, due to the client, something else to have to come up to actually make this work. And yeah, if we say Flash was a really cool platform to actually make animations, what is in there like on the other side? What else do we have? And I would say a really big, bold answer for that is actually HTML5. So HTML5 meaning kind of like collection of all the kind of open web standards that you can use nowadays on the web to create animations. So if I'm talking about HTML5 animations, as maybe many other people also do in the Common Sense, I mean everything around HTML5 Canvas or CSS3, also JavaScript libraries, everything that you can actually do out of the box in the web without using proprietary software. And yeah, you might wonder why actually would I want to use open web standards? I mean, yeah, probably the most obvious aspect of this is actually that you don't have to use proprietary software anymore. It makes it much more easier for you to actually get access to the tools that you want to use. Also, we have the advantage that you have a much different consistency. Browsers actually have to implement the web APIs or also like the features that you want to use beforehand, and will make actually a concentrated effort to do that. Obviously, we still have like deviations with different browsers, so, but this is, yeah, kind of like kept to a minimum, so this is pretty cool. And also, it's like available, so this means you don't have to rely on users to install any plugins or any kind of like additions to actually consume your experience. You can just create the feature and ship it on the web, so users can use it anytime, anywhere, also on their mobile devices. And this is a really great part about web standards. HTML5, yeah, you can use it for many other things that you also used for Flash before. We are only interested in the animation part, so just as a brief overview. And as already said, we are looking at HTML5, CSS3, and JavaScript as a kind of like descriptive kind of like word for these kind of animations. There are many others more, just want to shortly mention, but nothing that I will go further into in this talk. Yeah, regarding CSS3 transitions or animations, I just shortly want to show you that, yeah, probably many of you are also already familiar about this, but still, that we have the possibility only with CSS3, like really simple kind of markup language to actually say we want to have specific dynamic interactions in our elements. And this is like super cheap as well. So if you're using, for example, especially like this slide, the kind of like transform properties or also like the opacity properties, this is something that can be like easily be managed in the browser, and it's really high performant compared to many other properties that you would like to use. So if you can do your animation with these, this is already like a great start. And I think it's also really great for designers to make this actually approachable. JavaScript-wise, also just shortly want to mention that there are a lot of libraries, like a lot of them. So this is also really great. There's also a really popular one called GreenSock that maybe some of you might already have used. Also really approachable because it reminds a little bit of Flash, and a lot of people I think like it because of that. But this is not so much part of this talk. What I find more interesting is to actually look at native browser APIs that we have nowadays. There are several of them that you can use for animations. For example, also HTML5 Canvas is really popular. Compared to this, I found it interesting to go further into looking at the back animations API, mostly because I have the feeling that the HTML5 Canvas API seems like really really low level. So it's not that approachable as maybe like a nice JavaScript library that actually gives you certain methods to actually interact with your sequences or to actually draw simple shapes. So I found this really interesting when I heard about this. This is rather new, so already a couple of years in the draft kind of like stage, but still pretty fresh. And it will help us actually to synchronize animations with different models in the API that are defined, one of them the timing and one of them the animation model. And just to briefly explain how this could actually look like, if you were like a vanilla JavaScript world, you would, for example, define different keyframe effects. This is how they're called. So we look a little bit like just like CSS3 declarations of different animations that you would write in CSS3 anyway, which I think is really great for the developer experience because you go like, okay, I already know where this is coming from, right? And you can actually find these and attach them to elements and then say, okay, please create now from this element and these keyframes an animation that I want to play and to actually hook in with my my sequence handlers. So I think it's really cool. So let's have a look at how this actually could look like in Ember. So I think one of the biggest strengths of Ember are like the components. I don't know if you're like a big fan of like the Ember object model or something else, it's also cool, but I think a really great part around Ember is about the ability to actually compose different units of functionality and single units that you can also reuse across the application. And for example, if you wanted to create an animation, we could decide to create a comic panel component, right? Just write it down, and we could imagine maybe we have like a character or something that we want to animate in this comic panel. And the interesting thing is as well, with the Ember object model, we can actually say we want to extract, for example, the animations that we want to create out into our own declaration that is maybe coming like from an API or that we have just like bluntly defined in our controller for now, but nevertheless this is something that we can extract out of the component, making it more reusable in the long run. And the interesting thing is with the animation, for example, you have different opportunities to create them. What I really like to do is always just like take a sprite sheet, so like kind of like sequence of different images in one single file and just like flip through them, similar to like the carousel that we already saw with like different background positions. This is, for example, a way how you could do it. So for example, I could also look at how long my sprite sheet is and then just in the keyframe say, if you go through the animation, go from zero, so the start of my sprite sheet, to the very end. So this is already cool. We can plug this in into our comic panel component. And then we will realize, OK, how do we actually do this? How can we make it actually step through the different images that we have in our spreadsheet? In CSS world, I just learned about this also recently. It's like the steps function that actually can help us with that. So we can say, if you do the timing through the function, please don't do it like, for example, ease in, ease out, maybe you're familiar with that. Do this, please, actually steps, which is really cool. So we can do that. In the options kind of like property, we could also define a duration, how long we actually want this to happen, and also how often, which is really cool. And then, if we want to actually start our animation, we could set up a component and we could say at a specific time point in the component lifecycle that we want to actually check all the frames, we want to check all the animation options, and then in the end just animate that. So, if you've seen the last slide, hope the slide just comes after that. No, not yet. Okay. Just remember this last slide. Looks a little bit similar to something else that we have seen before or used before. And the best part is what I think that we also have a really approachable method to get to this actual actions, the handlers of our API. So in the Web Animations API, we have different functions for actually handling and controlling the sequence. We have play, we have pause, we have traverse. And you can actually do this on the animations that are attached to the timeline. I haven't shown this here, but what you actually have in the background of the timeline is like a kind of like document timeline object. And from this, you can actually get all of these animations that are currently attached to it. Like it's always like in the scope of one document. So if you're like on one side and attaching just like the animations to it, you would have like all of them in it, right? But what you can do then, you can just like get all of these animations and like play and pause them, which is cool. But what we also would like to have would be like multi-layered animations. And just like a sneak peek, it's not a full demo yet, but just to illustrate, the cool thing is as well, we can now create in our component several subcomponents that create like several layers. Because obviously, I cannot do so much with like a single comic character just running around like just like a plain landscape, right? I want to have some background, I want maybe have other characters running behind them or something, right? So I could actually say, okay, let's maybe create like a comic layer component which is inside of my comic panel, right? We could also add like several comic layers into it, either just defining them in a template or maybe also setting them up in a contextual component. And then we actually have the possibility to say, okay, we create all these animations inside of these comic layers, and then later on toggle all of this interaction from our comic panel component. So this is really cool. But what you might think, okay, this is actually not so much cooler than jQuery Animate, right? What is actually the great benefit of it? Actually, what I've shown so far is not that, I think, super strong point for Web Animations API now, but there are a lot of other features right now that are currently still in draft state, but which you can luckily... let's do this first as well. Maybe just to show you briefly how the browser support actually looks like right now. So with the Web Animations API, you can already use it. It's not like that. The only thing, as you can already see, is that browser support is still a little bit like diminishing. Internet Explorer, Edge, okay, we are not surprised about that. But for example, here we see that there's only partial support, and this refers to Element Animate. Oh, what's happening here? So this means what I've shown you so far with the jQuery Element Animate. This is something that you can already do out of the box in here. Also the playback control with the play and pause that I already shown. But many of the other features that are already kind of like in the draft state of the Web Animations API, they are not inside of this yet. So if you want to use these cool new features, you would actually have to, luckily someone is out for your rescue, you can actually use a polyfill. So this will kind of like support features in non-supporting browsers yet. So the normal polyfill would, for example, give you the opportunity to also do the element animate and the playable controls in Internet Explorer if you fancy that. And the good thing is as well that also new features can be implemented with the web animations next polyfill. And there's of course, because we're in Ember world, right, there's always an add-on for that, really cool. And so this also helps you with not having to always check is there like a new version of the web animations API, and usually you cannot really directly import it via Bower, so this will also help you, which actually is setting it up in your app, which is really cool. And once you have done that, you can, for example, use many of the new features of the web animations API. For example, you can use like group effects, which actually helps you to group together your animations so you don't have to attach them all globally to the document timeline, but actually in separate groups. So this is, for example, what we can do later on. If you create an animation with the animation constructor, we say we want to attach this group to the timeline. And once we have done that, we actually have the power to say, okay, I can actually control this single animation and I don't have to, with every time I call the pause, actually pause all of my animations in the entire page. So, yeah, this is already it, I think. So, thank you very much. And yeah, if you want to see the full demo, you can check out EmberConf if you don't have any flight tickets. You can also check out the video. And yeah, this is me, and looking forward to your questions.